For attending, I'm Baptiste Daroussin. I'm a port committer in FreeBSD since for almost a bit more than three years now. I'm a source committer for 2 years. I'm the author and the main developer of PackageNG, which is a new package system for FreeBSD. I gave a talk last year to explain you what is PackageNG. So this year it's not an explanation of what is PackageNG, but what you can do with PackageNG and how you can do modern package management with PackageNG right now. So first I'll give an introduction on some prerequisites you need to know before starting building packaging, using them and deploying them. Then I'll explain how you can create your own packages easily, run your own repositories, how you can just publish your packages if it's for system administration because you have huge a data center with FreeBSD everywhere and you want to publish all your packages on your boxes, or if you are a vendor and you want to publish just one, two, or three specialized package and be able to provide them to the users. I'll explain you what are the new features you have in the recent PackageNG which will help you to deploy your packages. We have started working on packaging base so that you can use PackageNG to install your kernel, install your system, upgrade it, and do things with all the base system. And I'll finish with some overview of the main features on the upcoming package 1.1, what we have done in it, what are the new things, and what we are already planning for the next versions. And if I still have some time, I will show you some example of what we can do with PackageNG, gels, and Beehive. So first, why do you want to build a package instead of using the mirrors that can be provided by PCBSD people, by FreeBSD people in a couple of months, couple of weeks? Because you may need some specialized package with non-default options. A lot of people are willing to, I don't know, remove X11 everywhere or add some support for special things. You probably want to have some specialized version and not the default provided by the port tree. For example, you want to get to keep the old version of Perl, or you want to have a special version of MySQL or anything else. You want to have your custom packages. I mean, you have something which is not in the port tree. It may be just because it doesn't exist yet in the port tree, or because it's your own code and you want to package it and provided the same way as you do with the rest of your packages. So you probably want to add your own ports and build them. And you want to manage your own stable branch of the port tree. You have an appliance somewhere. You have built all your packages based on a specific revision of the port tree. You want to keep your packages better than that, but probably you want to add some patches on it. So you want to keep this. In the whole time, what you had to be able to build your own packages was try to install Pointy Hat on your own system, which you might end up failing at because it's really complex setup. It's really hard to debug if you have some weird output somewhere or some failing packages. And it has some design bug leading to not really clean packages from time to time. You may have wanted to test Tinderbox. Well, problem is it's slow. I mean, it builds package one by one, and you don't want to wait for 2 days or a week to be able to get your packages for your systems. It's rather complex to install, not that much, but still rather complex. And it has the same design bug as Pointy Hat. So you might end up trying to build something with Clang because it has detected that Clang is on the host, but you are building for FreeBSD 8 and you don't have Clang on it and you have some package failing because of those design bugs. And you could have written your homemade scripts. A lot of people have done that. Problem is, most of the time, the homemade script doesn't build packages in a clean room, meaning that you can leak some dependencies you didn't want to have in your packages. Most of the time, it's slow. It's sequential building, so one after one after one, and you get long time before you get your packages, and you need to maintain it on your own, and so you need to follow what the new things are in the port tree to make sure that your scripts are still compatible with the recent versions. What we have now is we have a new tool called Poudrière, which means powder keg. And it's a package building factory. It's written to do some package testing, to be able to build, to do some quality assurance on them. It can be very strict, way more stricter than Tinderbox can be. So it can detect a lot of failures you have. I won't insist on testing and quality assurance when building the packages. But if you're a maintainer of some ports, or if you're a ports committer, you might be really interested in testing your package in your ports inside Poudrière. You will have funny results sometimes because it's really strict. It's also an operating system stressing tool. It is doing so much thing at the same time randomly that you end up having everything on your operating system stressed. Trust me, Dragonfly people, for example, have started using it and discovered a lot of bugs in the system, and they improved a lot their scalability, stability, and performance by just testing Poudrière on the system, because it was parallelizing so much thing different in the same time. Anyway, so if your system survive a full build with Poudrière, you can say you have some stable operating system. So how Poudrière works? First, it built everything in the clean room, in the sandbox. So when you are building a package, there is only the thing that has been specified as the dependencies that are on the system while building. It allows cross-compilation. So you can, you're on an AMD64 box, you can build packages for 32 bytes for any version of FreeBSD, as long as your host has the correct syscall. So usually your host is the most recent FreeBSD version available, and you can build for all the previous version of FreeBSD. We are working right now to include cross-compilation on MIPS and ARM destination based on Stacy work, and we currently are able to build almost half of the port tree for MIPS. It's a bit slow yet, but it will improve soon. So not in the next release of Poudrière, but in the release after, you will have something that allow you to build the packages for embedded environments. It's massively parallelized. If you have a if you're trying to build the packages in a box with 24 cores, by default, it will build 24 packages at the same time. You can do some tuning on that. You can say, oh, I just want to have 12 jails building packages and 12 threads, two threads per jail. You can do all the tuning you want, but by default, it's all the core I use all the time. It has deep integration with ZFS, which what allows Poudrière to be very fast is because we massively use the clone, the snapshot rollbacks from ZFS to be able to get back to clean room. But we also now are able to use Poudrière without ZFS, so you can run it on your UFS file system. It's a bit slower because you have to copy everything all the time. Or you can use it in full TMPFS, so if you have a box with large amount of RAM, you can build everything inside memory, and it's very fast. On the box we have right now available for port manager, we are able to build on a current with witness and invariants the whole port tree in 30 hours. It supports incremental builds. That means if you just update a bunch of ports in your port tree and you want to rebuild them, it will make sure that only those are rebuilt, and only it will make sure that what depends on those new ports are also rebuilt, so that you are sure that your repository is always consistent and is always working with all pieces together. If you want to maintain your external port tree, like you can have with the Xorg Double or GNOME, or you can have on your own system, you can easily use port checker with that. There is in port checker support for Poudrière, so you can just set up a special port 3 which will take the FreeBSD port 3, your own ports on your own SCM, and then merge them, and you have a port 3 where you can build everything. Poudrière is able to package ports, and soon I have all the patches for that. It is also able to, it will also able to package base. So you will just have to say Poudrière package base for this version, and you'll get a bunch of packages which correspond to your kernel, your base system, and things. So how Poudrière, we have tried to get something really simple. All the builders we used to have before Poudrière, I found them too much complex to use. And I wanted just something straightforward. So how Poudrière works is just to say, I want a jail based on the latest head. So I will create it. So I just say Poudrière jail dash C dash a name, which shouldn't be A, it should be a J. And a version, so I want head, and I want to get the sources out of SVN. It will take everything, it will build everything, and it will create for you a jail ready to build the packages based on the latest head. If you want to test some patches, so you're customizing the best system for your appliance, or your FreeBSD developer but trying to do some modification on base which could perhaps have some impact on the port tree, you can just specify dash P, and with the dash P you can just give your patch to it. It will build, it will create a jail with the most recent head, your patch applied on it, and then you can build all the ports on there, so you can do your own exprun. You can create out of a release, so it's not the right line, but if here you specify nothing, it will take the sets out of our own FTP, so you don't have to build anything, so in 20 seconds you have a jail ready without having to build anything. Here you just specify, in that case normally it should be 9.1-release, and it's done. And to be able to create jails for cross-compilation, for example for MIG64, you just have to specify the architecture, MIP64, and then it will do the cross-compilation, prepare everything so that you have a jail ready to build MIP64 packages. Now you have all your jails ready to be able to build the packages, you need a port tree, because all the definition to build packages are in the port tree. So you just create the port with dash C. You can, if you had dash P a name, you can have different port tree at the same time with different name, and you can switch building from one port tree to another, and you can play with that. If you want to create a single package, you just specify it on the command line on the bulk. So you say, I want to build on this jail, I want to build Apache, and you will get a few minutes later Apache with all the dependency being built from scratch. Of course, you can specify some customization through make.conf. You can specify make.conf per jail, per combination jail. If I use this jail, this port, this is this make.conf. And you can do special assets with the dash Z. So in that case, you can add, you can still reuse the same port tree, the same jail, but have some special options just for this particular set. So you don't have to maintain 10 jail based on the head if you just have different machines and you have one jail but different sets. And if you want to build the whole port tree, it's just bulk-a, nothing more. Fairly easy. So now that you have managed to build all your packages, you get a repository. If you have built them inside inside Poudrière, then this part is done automatically by Poudrière. This is basically creating a catalog of all your packages so that your clients can be aware of what is available on the repository you're proposing. If you want to sign the repository, you just specify at the end of the command a certificate, and then it will sign the repository so the clients can make sure that the package are the one coming from the right side, the right place. With package 1.1, we have activated the full multi-repository support, so you can have 5-6 different repositories where your packages are coming, and if you want to do a simple configuration of your repository without having by hand to edit every single package.conf or saying to a user, please add this line on your configuration, you can just create a simple package which will have just a small file, .conf, which is a YAML, and which is expecting a package sheet, which is a URL where you can find the packages. ABI is automatically expanded on the system, so it will only get the packages corresponding to the right version of FreeBSD it's using. You can specify your mirror type per repository, so we support two kinds of mirroring, which are HTTP, basically package ngjs dot and a first HTTP request. It gets a full list of different available mirrors, and it will try to get the package through the first one. If there is no package in that, it will fall back to the next one, and so on. Or you can have mirror type, which is RSRV, basically just querying the DNS records, the SRV records, and get a list of hosts where the packages should be available, and it will do the same. It will go through the first one, next one, next one, until it finds the package. Sorry? Yeah, sure. You have, in the package.conf, you have, you can, in 1.0, specify just HTTP proxy, and then it's done automatically. And in the package 1.1, what we have done is, now you have a key which is env, and you can specify every environment variable that are used by any of the libraries we are using, like libfetch. Then, in this repository configuration, you can add a pass to a key. So if you had this key in your package with this file, you can just, the user may be able to have it, and you can enable or disable the repository by default. Once you get this this into a package, you can just say to a user, do package add this pass, and you'll get my configuration for my repository, and your system is automatically configured to use the new repository. So what I ask the user is that go to my company, there is this txt file, add it, and your system is now able to get packages through my company. What protocol are supported to be able to deploy the package? We support HTTP, HTTPS, FTP, all of this comes from libfetch, so we have nothing in it. In package 1.1, we added SSH support. A lot of people were complaining on package 1.0 saying that, oh, it's cool, I have my packages, I have my repository, but I have to maintain a web server somewhere to deploy them. So you don't have to do that anymore. You can just share your some keys between the host, and you say you had SSH something into your package site. It will just do the writing. The only thing needed is you need on the hosting server, you need package install and the 1.1 version. So packaging base. Basically, what I did is adding two new subcommands to Poudrière. So it's straightforward for anyone. You just say, I want to have a package based on the latest SVN revision on head. And you can specify a script directory. The script directory is a directory where there is some YAML. So basically, you have kernel.script, base.script, etc. And it's if you want to do some special tuning in post-installation, post-upgrade, post-installation, everything, when you're setting up your jail. For example, if you want to add it on my set, I had something because I know exactly how the FS tab will be after an installation. So I just push this into the post-install script. If there is no FS tab yet, create it with this line. You can create it out of the, if you do that, it just fetches the latest snapshots that are available on the FreeBSD FTP server, and then it creates the packages out of those snapshots so you don't have to build. I only currently tested with head and stable, but it should work the same with releases and with the different releases branches. So The good thing with it is in the view I end up with this list of packages. I haven't been so far into splitting base because I don't want to go into a back shed about that. All I wanted is to be able to show that, yes, we can do that with package-ng if people are willing to go in that direction or willing to use this, we can do this. It's fairly easy to split it in more packages than this if you want. For example, if you want libc++ being used on your system, you can have a package which is libc++ and it will replace the libstandard C++ on the system. You can imagine everything you want in that case. If you're building on head and on stable, as I don't have any version, what I do is I give you the major version, then I add the date where the snapshots are from. What I've been able to do so far by packaging base is, before that, when you had to upgrade from 8.3 to 9.1, you used FreeBSD update. It was really, 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 really slow, long. It works. It works fairly well. And so you had to first upgrade your system, reboot, install all the new world, and upgrade your packages. And because you are changing the ABI, you use the static version of package, and you don't use the normal version. Upgrade-f say, OK, all my packages I have on my system, please reinstall them from the latest available in the remote repository. And because the ABI is automatically expanded, package static will detect that it doesn't need anymore to fetch packages from the 8.3 repository, but it will take the one from the 9.1 repository automatically. You don't have to modify any setup for that. It's totally automatic. What I have been already able to do, and what you could do on-site release next version of Poudria, is you can just do package install -f. When you do -f, it means that if it's already installed, you force reinstallation or upgrade of those files. First, you need to do, well, it's not world, it's base, but anyway. First, you need to do those two ones. Now, if you want to be really clean, you should first do kernel, reboot, then world. But most of the time, you can do those two ones, but not the packages that come with them, because otherwise, all the script from the packages will almost fail on you. You will upgrade packages based on the ABI you have before having upgraded. So first upgrade based on world, then reboot, and you can just upgrade -f the same way. Yes?
What do you do about PGC?
What we do is, currently, we don't do anything. So what I do is, on my scripts, I just remove from on my post-upgrade script, when I was creating the script here, I just know exactly I have a couple of files that are not the official one. So I remove them from the set. And I have, in post-upgrade, something that tests, OK, is it this one? If yes, I create. If yes, I don't touch it. If not, I upgrade it. So I do it manually currently, like this way. Thing is, in package-ng, we have a mechanism to mark a special file as being a configuration file. Problem is, when I coded this, I was only thinking about packages which have only one, probably two configuration file. When I try to use this with base, I end up with slash etc being totally messed up. There was files everywhere, and I had to go through each one and say, is there a difference? So it was really, really not a good idea the way I did it. So I'm reworking it. It will be in 1.2. And basically, what I'll do in 1.2 is, if a file is marked as a configuration file, then before upgrading, I'll check if the file has been modified since the previous installation. If yes, I keep the old one. I create a package new one belong to this one. And if I'm able to automatically merge, I will merge them automatically. Not by default, but you will have an option in package.com saying, try to automatically merge if you can. So normally, after an upgrade, you will end up with just a couple of files with package new. So it will be fairly easy to create your own merge master. And if you activated the auto merge, most of the time it will be just straightforward. So okay. So what we have done in package one, once in package one, is very important for us. We have stabilized a lot the foundation of what we have written first. So we have been able to activate by default full multi-repository support. Then you don't have any more single repository support. Everything is full multi-repository by default. We have added something which is an incremental catalog update, because so far what we did each time you did package update to get the latest catalog from the different repository is take the full metadata, bring them, so you have, when you have 24,000 package, you have a huge file, not that huge, but still too huge for me to download. So now what we do is we first fetch a small digest, and the digest, we have a look at the database you already have on your system, and if the diff between what is remotely and what is local is small, then we just fetch the bit we need and we upgrade your installation. If the diff is huge, then we took the raw one and replace yours. When we released 1.0, we said that the library API wasn't stable, because we were pretty sure that a lot of people were coming and say, oh, why don't you do that way? Why don't you do this that way? I don't consider myself as a strong C developer, so I was expecting a lot of people to come and say, here is the right way to do a library. We didn't have anyone saying such a thing since 1.0, but still we have simplified the API a lot. So now I consider almost stable with 1.1. It will be stable with 1.2, but you can start using it in your own project with 1.1. There won't be huge differences with the next version. It will be really stable with 1.2, which means we won't break any API until 2.0. We have done some massive performance improvements. Every single place where we had a lot of loops everywhere now, we use hash tables, which are very faster than when we used to have. We have added a couple of new comments. A lot of people were willing to, I want to upgrade everything. Okay, I understand the fact that a set should be consistent, so I upgrade my whole system at once. But for this particular package, I want to force it to stay at the old version. So now you can just package lock the package, and the package won't be upgraded anymore, won't be detached anymore. If you really want it to be upgraded, you first need to unlock it. A lot of vendors have been looking to PackageNG recently and asking to us, I want this in the package, I want this information in the package. And we have two choices, either hard code every single new information in PackageNG or provide them some freeform annotation. So now you can just add your own specialized things into PackageNG with package annotate. Package annotate will give you a list of key values. So you can say, I don't know, build from this server, or you can say, this is copyright, this company. I don't know what you will want to add to this, but you will be able to add all the information you need, and it will be bundled into the package so the user will keep it. So I already told about the SSH protocol, and we now have a new plugin interface. So the plugin interface has a public API, so you don't have to build the plugin inside the package source code. You know, you just have to include package-plugins.h, and you build, you link to the library, we provide a package config thing so that it's very easy to write plugins. Why we did that is a lot of people want features we don't want for FreeBSD, but we want them to be able to have them. We want to keep PackageNG simple, the more simple we can, because we want to be able to review it all the time, we want to be able to understand every single part of the code each time. But we also want people to have their own comments, and we also want to have people to have their own hooks inside the instrumentation of the installation of the upgrade of things like, or everything like this. So we have written a very simple API. Actually, I think it's really good. I'm not planning to change it anymore. So what does the API? Basically, you have to initialize the plugin. When you initialize the plugin, you just specify that I would need that kind of configuration. So I want a key value named this. I want a Boolean named this. But you don't have to do the parsing of the configuration file. It's automatic. So you will have configuration file which is consistent with package.conf. It will be a YAML file. You don't have to do all the parsing, all the checking if the values are there or not. You just say in the initialization, here is my list of configuration I need, and you get them. So later you just have to check. It's very easy. We have two kind of plugins. You can add new commands. Each time you add a plugin with a new command, if you do package with nothing, you will have the list of command and all the new plugins command are in. If you have already used Mercurial, it's been the same than when you had plugins to Mercurial, so you just have the list of new commands. And you have the hooks. The hooks can be done in almost all places of the instrumentation, of the upgrade, the installation. You can do each time I'm starting upgrading a package, I execute this. Each time I'm starting deinstalling a package, I execute this. Each time someone is searching something, I execute this before, this, after, etc. We will be proposing two different examples for this. One which is a new command, which is package plugin serve. Package plugin serve will basically you just do package serve. Package serve and the pass to your repository, and it will embed a web server on it, so you can just use it. Well, it's not useful anymore now that we have SSH, but still, someone can want it. And a plugin that I think a lot of people are waiting for, which is package plugin -dfs. Package plugin -dfs is expecting a configuration which is the list of the DFS file system you want to snapshot before every single package manipulation. And you have a pattern on it, if I remember well, you can add a pattern saying, I want the snapshot be named like this, 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 and this. So each time you will do package upgrade, you can snapshot first your system. So if something is wrong, you can do by hand the DFS rollback. You can imagine all kinds of plugins. I know that some people are already working on what I heard was a package build subcommand, which will basically be portmaster but merge inside a package engine plugin. There was a package tree, which just output all the install packages as a tree so that you know exactly where things comes from and where they're going. There was a company which was adding some plugins to be able to activate or not. They had some active passive versions of some packages. So through a special plugin, they were doing package activate this version, package deactivate this version. So limitation is when you use package static, you're not able to use the plugins anymore. So before going to the next version, one of the other things we have in package 1.1 is now all the options are self-documented. If you do package -v, you have the list, you have the version of FreeBSD of package. If you do package -vv, you have the list of options you have and what is their current setup. And if you add a new v, then you have a small description of what each option is. So normally we try to get the package.conf files up to date, but if sometime we miss something, you'll have it anyway in package-vvv. And after -vvv, you have the list of repository which are activated for your system. So for next version of package-ng, we are planning something. So currently we have two summer of code projects. Three, exactly. One which will happen for sure, because I'll mentor this one, which is providing us a pluggable solver. there is a lot of universities, laboratories, which are doing researches based on solvers, have been contacting by a bunch of them saying, oh, I want to test all my new algorithm. I want to push some student working on SAT solving. And I want to do this on PackageNG. So it's nice, but I don't want them to break the working solver. So what we'll end up is providing a default solver, which is the one we have now in package 1.1, which is different from the previous one. And we will allow anyone to write a plugin with its own solver. And if one day someone comes with a solver that is way better than the one we have, we can just switch it, push inside PackageNG as default the one that works, and still allow people to work on this. And this same summer of code, the students will also work on providing all the infrastructure to get the requires provides features. So instead of saying, I need, because I have a script in my package, I need this version of Perl, and we just say, I need Perl. I don't mind whatever version you use. So this is basic for most of the package system, but on FreeBSD, you have to depend on a special version of Perl for this, which is not good. Or if you're installing a web application, I don't want to say, I need Apache 2.2.4, and just want to say, I need an HTTP server, whatever it is. So we will provide all the foundation during the summer of code to be able to do that in PackageNG, and then we'll have to work on the port 3 to be able to provide the same feature, which would be hard, but we will work on it. Yes?
Is there a way to say, I need this version
so-and-so of a package? There is a way to say that inside PackageNG, but there is no way to say that from the port 3. So we are bounded by the port 3. We want to bring a lot of new things, but the port 3 is keeping us far from those kind of things, which should be the way it should work. And the other thing that is preventing us to go really further in package is we still have to support the old package installed. So the port 3 can't be moved to all those new things because of package install. That's a huge problem. Anyway. We also, in the summer of code, want to improve the multi-repository support. Currently, multi-repository support is you have all this list of repository. We're going through them. We're solving, saying, OK, I'll take this package from this one, this package from this one. But you probably want to say, I want this package to only come from this repository. So even if it's updated on another, on this one, I know it has my option. It is exactly what I want. Currently, if you want to do that, you just have to lock it. Unlock it after the upgrade of everything and say package install dash r, the name of my repository, install this one, or upgrade this one. This is not very user-friendly for this case. So we want to be able to say this one is stuck to this repository, or we want to say this repository has a higher priority over the others. Currently, the priority is the order you have defined the files. The files are read. So on your configuration file, if you make numbers before the name of the repository, then you get the name of your configuration file, then it will be read in the right order and in the way you have priorities on repositories. So if you have custom repositories with custom options and fall back to the FreeBSD one for all the rest, push yours in first and the FreeBSD one as a second. Yes? Yeah, that's. No, there is two things in priorities. There is a priority on the repository and the fact that we can mark this package to be preferred on this repository and only this repository. Both will be done during summer of code. After that, what we plan is to provide a mechanism to skip some files when you're installing on your system. If you're in an embedded environment, you don't want the docs, you don't want the man page, you don't want, I don't know what, you probably have some special things, you don't want all the .a files, you don't want, I don't know. So there is multiple ways to do that. You can do that by building the package without those files, or you can build the package as a full thing, but when you install, you just skip installing some parts. So you'll have some globbing pattern, a regular expression you will be able to add into your package.conf to say, I don't want this. We want to eliminate as much as possible, but I really want to have no script one day at all on any packages. Post-install scripts are great because I want to do some actions after an upgrade, after the installation. But the problem is, most of the time they are not reviewed by security people, so they can do strange things. Second thing is, if you do cross-installation and you're installing in you're on an MD64 box, you're installing in ARM root, for example, then it will try to execute things with the ARM FSH you are not able to run because you're still on your MD64. So it's something we really don't want in the future to keep any scripts in that. What we want to do is to provide a list of, a bit like what does CF Engine, which is providing a list of actions you can do. Those actions are coded inside package.ng saying, add a line to a file. You don't do echo or something, whatever you want. You say, add this line to this file at this point, or remove this line of this file at this point. We want to be able to provide this list, a list of default actions. Yes? You could do the cross-install thing with a QMU, for sure, with the emulation. You can do it, but... Yeah, there is a security reason, and anywhere, it's slow, you know, it's not straightforward. You need to have QMU installed, you can do cross-installation just out of a simple make release, for example, which is what I will want to do one day. Yes? Yeah, we have talked about that. Yeah, but still, I find it ugly to have package with scripts. Yeah, we have thought about that. So we will one day end up with that. Yeah. So now I can just try. I hope it will work. But I show you a simple example of using packages for base. You can see, I don't know where. Like this? No. That one. That screen.
Top row.
Okay. That works. Okay, so. The use case is I want to provide some Beehive virtual machines, but I first want to be able to work on setting them up before starting the virtual machine. So I probably want to first create a jail, configure everything in the jail because jail is very simple to use. And then if I'm happy with my jail, I can just add a kernel into the machine and then say, okay, now it's a VM for Beehive. So what I do is I create an empty directory. I have already prepared ZFS volume to be the raw device for this. So what I do is just formatting this so I'm sure that there is nothing in it. The directory is still, I need to mount. Oh yes, TMP. Okay, so I moved on it. I have nothing in that directory. So I'll create a persistent jail. So if I do GS, I have my VM, my jail, which is started. then I already have the sets created on my system, and I have a web server running. So what I need to do is to specify the ABI I'm installing the package to, because we are automatically determining the ABI based on BinSH, which is not there yet. If you need to specify to do some resolution, you don't have any etc/resolve.conf, you can just add an environment variable which is name server equal 8.8.8.8, for example, and then the resolution will be done that way. So in my case, I just want to install FreeBSD base. Okay. We have tried to improve the output of package engine 1.1. So now you have the number of actions that will be done at the beginning of the lines. We are really willing to get feedbacks about people. We want to improve all the error message, the warnings, the output of the tool, so that it's really good for users. So I still have some warning I shouldn't have yet, but I haven't fixed all my scripts, my percentile scripts. So right now I have Magile, which is installed. So if I go inside the jail, I should be able to get in. So I'm in the jail. Everything is there, so I can do my configuration, probably install things. I have no package inside the jail, so I can't determine what's in it. But if I do I know that I have the FreeBSD base system installed with this version inside the jail. Now I will add I think I'm happy with this, so I will add the kernel. Inside jail. So now I just need to stop the jail. Umunt. And I can start Beehive with this. Oh. And normally, it should be booting a FreeBSD system. So if I had some I didn't get time to create new sets, so I said normally, okay. So I forgot to configure the last part of, I forgot to configure the console. So anyway, normally I should be able to log in, but I don't have the console activated, so I don't get into it, but it has worked. It has booted, so it works. If you have new sets, you can just do package upgrade and you install both. You can upgrade both the kernel and the system. Okay. So we have just yesterday relocated the package engine repository inside the FreeBSD organization in GitHub, so that people can know now where it is. If you want to have a look at Poudrière right there. Poudrière is having no dependency at all. It's only something like 2,000 lines of shellcode, and it's readable. Really, it's not because it's shellcode, it's really readable. So you can have a look at both. Do not hesitate to ask us any questions. There is also Brian, who is over there, who has done a lot of, who is there, has done a lot of work recently on Poudrière and PackageNG. If you have any question now, yes? Yeah, In the delta diff between packages, you mean? I just fed the delta between. We were working on this. So first, we need to solve one thing is the predictability of the package building. Currently, each time you build a package, you get a diff from checksums. So you can't make diff on based on this. So we had some work on to be able to do that, except that for packages like Python and everything, almost everything that have some bytecodes, we get into problem because when we did that, we basically faked all the dates to be epoch and make sure that everything is from epoch. And the Python was not liking it at all. Same for Perl. And I don't remember we had some problem like this. But for the base system, this has already been solved by FreeBSD update. So if we use the same mechanism as FreeBSD update, which is not yet the case on what I've done, we should be able to go that way. So yes, it's something which is planned. It's really not easy to get to, but we really want that. Because if I upgrade base or LibreOffice, which is almost as big as base, I just want to get the new bits. I don't want to get the full package each time. OK. Yes? Oh. Where was it? No. Got it. Thank you.